Well, now we need to understand what the spirit is. So let's go there, because there, this is the scripture that also that some use to teach that our loved ones are living in heaven right now. And if you understand anything from what I just read and all these scriptures, that's not true. The Father says they are in the grave, non-participators in anything. So let's find out what the spirit is. If we go to Galatians 5 and read that, we can end up having one of a couple of spirits. We can have a good spirit or righteous spirit, or we can have a mean or evil or wicked spirit. But we're going to separate that by reading Galatians 5. Now, we're going to start at Galatians 5, verse 19. It says, "Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of which I tell you before, as I have told you in time past, that they which do these things shall not inherit the kingdom of God." Now, these characteristics are what? Unrighteous, wicked, evil spirit characteristics. Characteristics of the enemy. These are some or all that some of us manifest, and some of us die with these characteristics. We die unrighteous. This is what we're dying with. Now, the fruit of the Spirit, or the righteous characteristics, are these. Verse 22, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law." So, we can have one or two characters, one or two spirits, unrighteous or righteous. This is what Galatians 5 is talking about. Now, nevertheless, we're still talking about character and the fruit of it, or spirit, good or evil. People have good spirit, people have evil spirit, or character. Now, the spirit is what? The breath that the Father gives us, which brings us to life. And with that breath, the spirit of the Father himself, or his character, is put within us. Scripture does not teach that he is putting another being in us. Remember, if he breathes into you, in fact, go with me to Genesis 2:7, and it reads like this. It says, "And the Lord formed man out of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul." Now, the word has just told us that we're made from two elements, the dust of the ground and the breath from the Heavenly Father. It says nothing about putting another being in us. Why would he have to put any kind of a being in us and then create a body around it? We have angels in heaven that are created beings. Now he has man. There would be no sense to take a created spirit and then add a body to it. Just think about some of these things sometime. It says he formed us out of the dust and his breath, and he breathed into us life. This is what causes us to live. And man became a living soul. A soul is a man. A man is a living soul. A dead man is a dead soul. A body without breath. A body and breath are a living soul. Keep that in mind, people. His breath is what brings a soul to life according to his word. His word, not mine. So if we go back to Ecclesiastes 12:7, which reads, "And the spirit shall return to God who gave it." When someone dies, that spirit or that breath goes back to him who gave it. And within that breath is what? The character, the heavenly character of the Father, his spirit. That's what it's referring to. It's not saying that there's another being. Like I said, why would you have to take a being and add something to it? If it is, it already is. So that breath goes back to the Father who gave it. And this comes from what? Genesis 2:7. Understand this, we're born of sin, so that trait, that character of the enemy is already in us. That sin nature is already in these bodies. And then the Father breathes his spirit into us. And then all that's left is to see what manifests over the course of our life. And we get to pick and choose what our character is going to be, whether they end up with a heavenly spirit or an evil spirit. And we die according to whatever spirit we're in when we die. So, when we die, Psalms what? 104:29 reads like this. It says, "Thou taketh away the breath, and they die, and return to their dust." So when we die, the Father takes his breath away. He gave it. It goes back to him. That's what the word tells us. And we what? Return to the dust. Now, this scripture, like I said, it falls in lines with Ecclesiastes 12:7. But notice one thing about this scripture. It says that he takes his breath away, and Ecclesiastes 12:7 says that the spirit shall return to God who gave it. So what I just said is being addressed in two separate scriptures. The breath is being taken away, and within that breath is the spirit or the character of the Father himself. It goes back to him. Remember Galatians 5:22-23 told us what spirit is. It told us what the fruit of that character or the fruit of that spirit is, love and all those things. The Father, that's the Father. He gives us that when he breathes into us. That is the spirit that he's putting into us. But like I said, we get to pick and choose what we're going to make of it as we grow. And we see everybody's not one or the other. And some people try and be both. Now, let me address this. We all know that sometimes when people die, that they're primarily buried, cremated, or what have you. Now, first, don't be so rattled, because people can really get rattled by this kind of stuff. But don't be so rattled as to what happens to a person's body when they die, because if you really sit back and look at it, people die in all sorts of ways, and sometimes bodies aren't even accounted for. But remember, the body will, no matter how we die, it will see corruption. It will go back to the dust. It will degrade to the elements from which the Father created it. So it doesn't matter how we die, where we die, or whatever, that's going to happen. The body will go back to the dust from where it came. And remember that the Almighty, he has the ability to put any and all of us back together. He created us. So don't get so caught up into whether someone's buried, cremated, or worse yet, mutilated or burned up or what have you. All these different types of deaths happen. The Father has it in his power to do whatever. He can put any of us back together. Now, understand this, even King David. See, we're going to bring up King David because some of you aren't even really aware of that. The word even says that even King David, a man after our Heavenly Father's own heart, is in the grave, went to the grave and saw corruption. If anyone, he would have been one of those few to not see corruption and would have been called straight to heaven. But here yet is another example of someone that the Father loved so much and someone that was righteous in spite of what he did. He still went to the grave and he still saw corruption. Now, go with me to Acts 13:33-37, which read like this. It says, "God hath fulfilled the same unto us, their children, in that he hath raised up Jesus again. And it is also written in the second Psalm, Thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee. And as concerning that he raised him up from the dead, now no more to return to corruption, he said on this wise, I will give you the sure mercies of David. Wherefore he said also in another psalm, Thou shalt not suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. For David, after he had served his own generation by the will of God, fell on sleep and was laid unto his fathers and saw corruption. But he whom God raised again saw no corruption." See, scripture refers to David and lets us know that he died, even though he loved David. But he died and went to the grave. But it also makes reference to raising our Savior. He saw no corruption. Now, one thing we have to keep in mind too, scripture refers to death as sleep. Think about this. If you're going to die and be raised again, are you permanently dead? Well, if you're going to be raised again, then you're not permanently dead. So in a sense, you can look at it as being in a state of sleep. So this in part can be a reason why scripture refers to death as sleep, because no matter how long it is, it's still a state of sleep. Even when we sleep at night, in a sense, we're practicing death. Think about it. The difference is sometimes that we are aware of things, and we may even dream and be aware of that, and then we wake up the next day. But there are times when you sleep, you have no awareness of what's going on. You don't remember dreaming anything, but you just wake up to a new day and all that time has passed. This is going to be no different than for all those dead ones out there when they are awaking at the second coming. They're going to wake up in the same frame of mind as if it were just the next morning or next day or what have you. And they're not going to have the awareness that months, weeks, years, hundreds of years, thousands of years have passed. And then one day, 1 Thessalonians 4:16 is going to happen and cause all that to happen. And it reads, it says, "For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, and the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first." See, once we go down to death, people, the word simply says that whether we're here or there, wherever, we will see corruption. We return to the dust from where we came, and the breath of life, or that spirit, goes back to the Father who gave it. The word tells us this: our dearly departed loved ones are securely asleep or dead, whatever, however you want to phrase it. They are there until the Father returns to raise them and us. Once we go down and us, he will raise us when that time's come. So when that time comes, then that will all happen. Now, I know that the parable of Abraham's bosom, that's out there, and this teaching is really about the separation, the great separation between man and God, sin and righteousness. But people use this to teach that people are in heaven. But that's another study altogether. So anyway, people, with that, I'm going to stop right here, and we'll see what happens. And with that being said, this is Brother Lloyd. I'm out.